Everybody here? Am I on? Mike, check the phone, check it. Come on. Mike? Oh, now I'm on. All right, cool. What's up? We got some little ones here? Yes, Melanie and?
Michaela.
Michaela. And Carson, think you're medium. And Elias, you're medium too.
He's in the middle.
All right, so we had another interesting just get together. It's been a long day for a lot of people, which is great that it's, you know, right before the weekend, because it just gives everybody the time to come out here and get back into the presence of the Lord and remember that he's got everything under control. He knows everything that you're going through right now. He knows how busy your day was. He knows how stressful your life has been. He knows. And I think it's awesome that you guys came out here tonight. Just your obedience in that of like, I want to know more about God. I want to come on a Friday night when most people on a Friday night, you know, it's club night, it's go to the bar night, it's like chill, play some video games, and smoke some weed night to a lot of people. I'm not going to front. That was me a long time back, like 3 years ago. That was Friday night. So God can do amazing things in 3 years, I'll tell you that. So we're really excited that everybody came out tonight. We're really excited for just everything that God's been doing here as well. Like Ryan and Michelle and Michaela said, we have the GOD, the Gather, Open, and Donate. Open is Dressel's Farms this Sunday at 2 o'clock. You can either meet us there at 2 o'clock, or you can meet us here at 1 o'clock if you want to drive over with us. But there's going to be apple picking, some corn mazes, and some hay rides and all that kind of fun stuff, and apple cider and hot donuts.
Yes,
that's all I'm going for. And hot donuts, right? And then the D, like Michaela was saying, that's a great opportunity to just come out and help. When families are going through some struggles at that time, it'd be great to help them out. So let me just pray for the night. God, thank you so much for getting us here tonight, Lord. Thank you so much for just continuing to love us and care for us and encourage us and just fill us with fire every single day, Lord. We praise you, God. We give this as an offering to you, Lord, of this service, God. And we just ask that you would just open up every single heart here, Lord, that you would just open up every mind, that you would allow the word to come through, that everyone would comprehend it, and that, Lord, that you would just keep my mouth shut if there's anything that I have to say, and that you would just speak through me wholeheartedly tonight, God, and that you would just completely just speak to the people out here, God, of what they're going through, Lord. And we just thank you so much, Lord God, for everything we are doing through this ministry and through each individual one of our lives. We just love you so much. In Jesus' name. So as I was saying before, how we kind of got off to we're running around really trying to get things set up today, and it like came to me during worship, and it was like, if we didn't have this big church, would you still come? If we didn't have instruments and lyres and drums and great singers and great voices, would you still come? If we didn't have nice, comfortable chairs and water and Dawn's amazing desserts that she brings every Friday night, would you still come? And I think that the Lord has that same question a lot of the time, where he's like, if I wasn't so decorated, if I was just who I am, because that's who I am, would you still come? Would you still come to me as a holy God, just the way that I am? Because what's beautiful is he takes us just the way that we are. Wherever we're at right now, he wants us just like that. and his desire is for us to look more and more like him as we continue to walk out our salvation and our journey with God. So last week we had a break for me, which was great because I had a break for me. And I could just relax through the week and not stress about the Lord providing a word, which kind of don't even do that anymore. He always provides something to say, and I have enough to say on my own. So there's always something that will be said here on Friday. But last Friday we had Brother Fount Schultz. He's a teacher, a gifted teacher that came out on Friday night. He came out on Saturday morning. He came out on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Monday night. There was a lot of God going through this church. A lot of God's word is being taught through this whole entire last probably 2 weeks. And then right into that, we had the Bible study on Tuesday. And right into that, we had our prayer night here on Wednesday. And even did a little bit of study then as well. It was awesome. It was awesome. I remember when I first started on my walk with God, that something like that was kind of just like, I got my daily dose on Sunday, and I'm good. Like, I just want to relax. And now, I just get more and more excited that a whole week of God. And initially, it seems like, oh man, this is a lot. But once I get in the midst of it and continue to persevere and just continue to lay down my life, it's amazing what God does. So Brother Fount talked about the glory of God on Friday. He talked about the light of the world. He used Isaiah 60, where he says, "Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you." It was awesome. Just two phrases right there. Arise and shine, your light has come, the glory of the Lord rises upon you. He says, "See, darkness covers the earth, and thick darkness is over the peoples, but the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn." He talked about, and when we walk into a room, people should just already know that there's something going on there. When we walk into our schools, there's something different about that kid. I don't know what it is. When we walk into church on Sunday in this building, something's going on with that congregation. Something's going on between the midst of those people. I've heard stories of people just walking into a church and just falling down. They didn't even really mean to do it. Just the thickness in the presence, the powerful presence that was just in the room. They just couldn't even handle it, and they just fell. Oh, I want to live in those days. I want to live in those days where God is so deep and just ripping through us everywhere that we go. We started this series called Why Not Us? And the first message that we had was a lot about, like, why not you? Why wouldn't God use you? Why wouldn't he? The answer is, he does. And we learned through the story of Jeroboam and Rehoboam, and this man of God from Judah who didn't even have a name. It was just a man of God from Judah. No name. And yet the Lord still used him mightily. And we learned through that night that the Lord calls us to little things and he calls us to big things. He chooses to do little things through us and chooses to do big things through us. But something that's really interesting is what I've noticed, and this has been just kind of hitting me over the last week, that I've always had a passion and a desire for something big to happen. I've always had a passion and desire for God to just do something really big through me. And God kind of met me where I was yesterday. And he said, "Would you be okay if I just wanted to do something small for you, would you be okay with that? And at the same time, we have someone that the Lord wants to do something small through, and we're okay with that. We're a person, we're like, you know what, I'm really cool with just, Lord, you could do something small for me. I'm really comfortable the way that I am. I'm content with that, and I'm good with that. And then the Lord comes and he says, hey, I actually want to do something really big for you. And we're like, no, I'm like in this small zone here. Whatever it is, whatever comes to surface, whatever the Lord says, big, small, medium, in between, are you okay with it? Are you okay with just serving coffee? Are you okay with just being an encourager? Are you okay with starting a church? I don't know what the Lord's calling you guys to. You're good, baby girl. You're good. This is dance. That's a dance break. Yeah, it's a dance break right there. That's big. That's how good God is. Yeah, all right. Just make it flow. All right. I'll get too much over here. Give him an opportunity here. Stephanie's still repping the Yankees hard. I love it.
Yes.
Like, I don't care that loss. I'm repping them hard.
Yeah, it says, don't some bash my Yankees.
I'm just saying. It's getting kind of hot in here.
I'm just saying.
We play tonight. That's what I have to
do. It's okay. We still got 27 titles on our belt.
When we get enough money, we'll get there.
It's okay.
All right. Let's get back to this. So, the second night we talked about why not us? Why not the light of the world? Why not God do something powerful through the light of the world? Why not? He chooses whoever he so desires. And those people that he desires, where are we at? Are we saying, yes, God, yes? It's kind of been this whole message through the series of, yes, God, yes. Whatever it is, small, big, us, together, individually, yes. Why not us? Was that second question? Was that second service? Because now that we're in a time period, the apostles came, they went around individual, they spread the gospel everywhere, and churches formed through the works that they established. And the church as a whole is the body of Christ, and we glorify him together. It's everybody, individuals coming together in a body. And it's a beautiful thing when that all really happens. But tonight I asked the same exact question, why not us? But in the form of, why can't it just be us? Like, why can't I just do whatever I want? Why can't we do whatever we want? Why can't it just be us? Holy Spirit, lead. We are a strong people. Especially right now, we are reaching a generation where it's all about me and I can do it. And I don't need help. And I'm independent. And I can do it on my own. Me. I bet you there was more selfie photos in the last day than there was photos in general the first year that they were created. It's a blanket statement, but you think, right? I was watching videos like of like these baseball highlights where there was like the game and they were like zoomed in on like this group of like eight girls and they're all just kind of and we're like, what? The game's on! And it's spiraling in from insecurities. We're trying to grab self-worth through social media. We're creating our perfect picture identity of who we are through social media. But we're in a time where it's strong. I can do this on my own. I can do this. And there are people out there that are amazing. Like, the just the skills that they have. the mindset, the intelligence. It's amazing. It's incredible. I have made the statement here that Stephen Hawking is the dumbest man that walked the face of the earth. He's the dumbest man. We'll get into that tonight. Maybe y'all will put that together. He has to be. He knows so much, but doesn't know the key thing. There's this guy, J.D. Anderson. I don't know if you ever heard of him before. But he's this really powerful dude. Ryan, do you have that ready to roll? Go ahead and play this quick video here. This dude, J.D. Anderson. Things just with his body. He's powerful. And he shows the example through this video of how strong he is and how powerful that he is. Cage is like, oh, he's gonna maybe use the hockey stick to practice, and it's just
just like right in front of the ball. You don't want to get in front of that serve. Nate, you want to get in front of that serve?
No.
Nate plays tennis. He can hit like 150.
163.4 miles per hour. That's power. That is strength right there. There's a guy, George Hood. Anyone ever did these planks before?
You get like down like that, and you kind of do the planks. That's it.
This guy, George Hood, did a plank for 5 hours and 15 minutes. Hell of a plank. Do we have one? Don't worry about it. 5 hours and 15 minutes. Who's not done like a plank before? Everyone's attempted a plank before? For the most part?
I
mean, you get to the minute mark and it's just like, whoa, this is the real deal here. I remember growing up, once I got into college, I got introduced to rugby. Because I was always that, like, I gotta be strong, I gotta be big, I gotta be powerful, I need people to look at me and see that I'm a strong guy, I'm strong, I can take it, I can take a hit, and I can hit somebody. And I played rugby, and I was a madman out in the field. I would be hitting myself out there, psyching them up. When they came to catch the ball, it was like this, because I was just there, like, like just ready to just take them out. After these games, we would go all together to these bars, and we would sing rugby songs. We would sing rugby songs about how strong we are, and about how big we are, and about how good we look. It was all about us. It was all about the strength that we could possess on our own, without God. That's all it was. And we sang these songs. I want to try something here. Y'all just repeat after me. This is a rugby song. Y'all are going to learn a rugby song tonight. We came to this mountain. And y'all have to have like the intensity too. You match my intensity with this whole thing here. We came to this mountain.
We came to this mountain.
Too tall to go over it.
Too tall to go over it.
Way too wide to go around it.
Way too deep to go under it.
So we went through it. We are warriors. We are big. We are strong. We have guns. And bullets too. Woo. We came to this river. This big, big river. Way too big to go over it. Way too wide to go around it.
Way too deep to go under it.
So we went through it. We are warriors.
We are big.
We are strong. We have guns. And bullets too.
Woo! How do you go through water?
That's the thing. We're just so big that we can go through the water. I mean, the rugby team in general was big. I got one more. We came to this forest. This jungle, wild, crazy forest. Way too big to go over it. Way too wide to go around it. Way too deep to go under it. So we went through it. We are warriors. We are big. We are strong. We have guns. Bullets too. Woo.
And that was one of our rugby songs that we sang. And it got kind of crazy up in there. The people were just like, these madmen are just gloating and like breaking stuff. And they're so big and they're so powerful. And this is too much. We're a strong people, but we're absolutely nothing without His power. Our strength, our independent strength, can't even come close to His power. Can't even come close to His glory. Can't even come close to His wisdom, to what he knows, the unsearchable. We're not even close. So when I go into the gym like once every month, I feel good about walking around those big guys. Because I walk in and I'm like, I'm bigger than you. No, no, I am so much more bigger than you, you could never even imagine of how big I really am. Like, are you kidding? You're like $160. I'm like, bro. I'm like, you don't know what I have. You don't know what I could unleash right here if the Lord so see it. You don't know. Because he's powerful. But we are in a generation where it's just believe in yourself. You can do it. It's the motivational speak. You can do it. Just believe in yourself. But if you only believe in yourself, you'll only get as far as yourself can take you. And I got a God that I serve that can bring you so much farther than yourself could ever bring you. I can do all things as long as I have my girlfriend. I can do all things as long as Carson laughs at my jokes. I can do all things as long as I have some money saved. I can do all things as long as I have a high position in the church and I can play. I can do all things if I can score a goal or play basketball really good. I can do all things if I just had some fame. I can do all things if I just had a really good career where I didn't have to worry about anything. I can do all things if I had a really good boyfriend or a really good husband or a really good wife, which I do. But I can do all things. It's not what the scripture reads to me. Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Isaiah 33:2 says, be gracious to us. Lord, be gracious to us. We long for you. Be our strength every morning, our salvation in the time of distress. He gives power to the weak and strength to the powerless. So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. But not my left hand. Just kidding. It was a joke that we had in the Bible study on Wednesday. We're like, the righteous hand, but not my left hand. There's a different meaning here. Psalms 27:1. It says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Bring them to me. Bring somebody to me. Bring a problem to me. Bring an issue to me. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers came upon me to devour me, my adversaries and my enemies, they stumbled and they fell. Though a host of the enemy came against me, my heart will not fear. Though war arise against me, I will still be confident because of my Lord. Whew. Bring it to me. Bring it to me that says that I should be afraid of it. In Psalms 18:2, it says, the Lord is my rock, my fortress and my deliverer. My God is my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield in the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. Powerful God. Powerful God. Powerful, powerful God. And all he wants us to do is acknowledge it. The Lord wants us to rely upon him. I heard when I came to Christianity, oh, you just use that as a crutch. Yes, I do. Absolutely. 100%.
because I wouldn't be able to walk on my own. He is my crutch. He is my wheelchair. He is my car. He is the way that I get around. He is the way that I have things that come to my head, and He's the way that I'm able to work and provide for my family. He is the way that I can be a good husband. He is the way to everything. So yes, He is my crutch. What's yours?
Well, I don't need a crutch. I'm good.
Oh.
How's that working? He doesn't want your strengths. He wants your weakness. We said it on Tuesday as well. I put it all in your hands. It's one of the most powerful things that you could ever say. That's powerful. I put it all in your hands. Oh my gosh, you don't know, Dustin, you don't know what you just did. Because you tell me those kind of things like that every single day. Oh, watch. Watch what's going to happen. If you're really putting it all in my hands, and your heart is really saying, I put it all in your hands, oh, the things that will come. 2 Corinthians 12:9-10 says, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. Whoever the weakest person is here right now and acknowledges it is the strongest one. You're the strongest one here. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses. Oh, bring on the weaknesses. I love it. In insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. I hear so much about this generation of Christians right now. Not all of them, but some of them, where it's, man, the government's against us. Man, this person's against us. Man, this person insults us. Man, this person won't leave me alone. Yes, keep doing it. That just shows that I'm walking like I should. If there's not persecution coming at me, then I'm not lining up with Scripture, because Scripture says that I was persecuted, so you will be persecuted. Bring on the persecution. Government's around really bad. So what? The Lord's in charge. There ain't nothing we can do about it except complain. And every time that we complain, we actually put power into their hands. There is an unseen realm, the spiritual realm, and every time we complain about higher authority, every time we complain about higher power of how they're working out this whole entire world, we are feeding it. We are giving them the power that God gave us, and we're giving it to them. Because here's the thing, Satan is defeated. Satan has been conquered. He lost a long time ago. He has no power. So the only place he gets his power from is us. We give it to him. Here you go. Brother Fount spoke about that on Friday. About how all this power the Lord has given us. And we said, here you go, Satan, you can have it. Because he doesn't have anything. He can't do anything. He's defeated. And it's right in here, the acknowledgement of that. So when a problem happens, it's an acknowledgement of this, of no, wait, you've been defeated. The only time he has power is when we give it to him. I want to tell you a story about a man named Gideon and an army of men that were never supposed to win. Never. In the eyes of the people, in the eyes of the enemy, they had no chance. Since the beginning of time, the Lord has desired to have relationship with us. And we got to a point in time where God's people, the Israelites, said, just give us a law. Just give us something that we could follow. They couldn't do it by sight. They didn't have any faith. They said, just give us a law and we'll follow this and we're good. That law that just do's and don'ts. It inherit. It's all the way back to the Garden of Eden. Where there was a tree of knowledge of good and evil. And God said, don't touch the tree, guys. Don't do it. And they did it anyway. And Satan convinced them and said, you're going to know everything that God knows if you do this.
And they took a bite of the forbidden fruit, and all of a sudden their eyes were open, and they knew what God knew. They knew. And they got to a point where it's like, well, wait, if we just know what's right to do and what not to do, then we don't need any relationship with you. We just have a law here, and we'll just follow the law, and then we're good. And the Lord's like, no, I wanted to talk to you. I wanted to communicate with you. I didn't want you to just follow a piece of paper or make a whole list of all the good deeds that you've done in your life. I didn't want you to just work for it to show how well you could do it on your own. I want a relationship with you. And over the course of time, God's people continued to stray away from him. Moses had brought God's people all the way up to the edge of the promised land, and they complained the whole way. Joshua brought them into the promised land. And the Lord said, everybody here, everybody that is in your land needs to go. They don't belong here. This is your land. And they came in without an understanding, without an acknowledgement of that, and without enough faith that the Lord was truly speaking real. That the people that were living there kind of hung around. They stayed there. They couldn't get out. The Israelites weren't acknowledging enough of the Lord that they would really flee, all of them. So they stayed, and they mingled among them. And they started taking up their bad things that they were doing. They started following their false gods because they let them hang around. And what happened was, after Joshua had died, all God's people were like, what do we do now? We were following like one guy, and like, you know, we had Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, to Joseph, to, you know, to the 12 tribes, and we got Moses and Joshua, but now we don't even have anybody. And God said, just go through the tribe of Judah. The tribe of Judah will lead. But it got messy, and we entered into a period of what's called Judges. If you read in the Bible, there's a book called Judges. But the whole picture is God's people straying away and bringing them back together. And God raised up these judges to do that. So the people would stray away, a judge would come and bring them back together. They would stray away again, and then a judge would come, and he would bring them back together again, and again, and again. And we reach this story of Gideon, where it's his turn to bring them back together. The Bible says that they had peace for 40 years before this time period happened. They were good for 40 years. They were following the Lord. Everything was great. Peace in the land. Peace. Then it says, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord, and for 7 years he gave them into the hands of the Midianites. Because the power of Midian was so oppressive, the Israelites prepared shelters for themselves in mountain clefts, caves, and strongholds. God's people were supposed to take authority in that land that they had. God gave them all of that land. He gave it to them. They were supposed to be the glory of the Lord on the face of the earth, so that everybody from east to north to west to south would notice that these are God's people. And here they are, living in mountains, in caves and strongholds. They reached a point where they're like, you know what, God, we're good. We can do this on our own. We're good. We're really happy here. You know, we're good with these mountain strongholds and caves. We're good right here. Just leave us be. Here's the thing. We can't choose. We can choose. But if we don't choose him, then we open up ourselves to him. Satan. See, God came to protect us and to give us that covering. And here the Israelites are, they're like, Satan, we don't want nothing to do with you. And God, we like you, but we kind of want to do it our own way. And God's just like, I mean, okay, do it your own way.
And because they wanted to do it their own way, Satan was just like, you know, if you want to do it your own way, you're just giving me complete authority to do whatever I want with your life. Whatever I want. Because God is your only protection, God is your only covering, and if you don't want to do it His way, then I just have permission to do whatever I want. Because God was the only one strong enough to defeat me. We're not strong enough to defeat Satan just by ourselves. It's God through us that defeats him. We're co-heirs with Jesus. That's why he's been defeated, and he has no authority in our life. But if we say, we don't want anything to do with you, God, we like you and everything, but I ain't really trying to follow you that much, then Satan's just like, well, then you're not strong enough to take me out. I'm going to have a field day with your life. And this is what's happening right here with the Israelites. They're supposed to take dominion over this land. They're supposed to be strong and powerful people with God working through them, and here they are out in mountains, strongholds and caves. The Bible says that the Midianites would come to them and take all their crops and take all their animals away from them. So here they are, they're like, we're good, God. Satan, we don't want nothing to do with you. We're just on our own here. We're okay. You know, this is, I see the crops are actually finally starting to grow. I'm finally starting to see the grass grow a little bit greener on the other side. How many of us kind of see that in our life when we walk out? When we say, you know what, things are kind of getting better finally. They're finally getting good. I finally caught a break. We're good. The crops are coming up. You know what? I know life's not that great, but the crops are coming up and we're all right. And we can make it on our own. We can do it. And here comes these Midianites. They come in, punking them. They're bullying them. And they come in. Hey guys, yeah, you got some nice crops here. Yeah, we'll be taking these. Thank you. I got some nice turnips there. Thank you. Ha! Ha! Just like a bully coming into a kid with lunch money. And the kid's just like, here you go. They were terrified. They were living nowhere near where God called them to live. They're a bunch of chickens. They didn't recognize the power that the Lord had with them. They didn't recognize that they were already defeated. They were done with. And the Midianites were like, this is awesome. We're just going in. They're basically just making food for us. We're taking all their crops. We're taking their animals. And we're kicking dirt in their face on the way out. And they're like, peace out. And see you later. Finally, it was too much for God's people. Finally, once again, how many times will we come and go and come and go and come and go? And they cry out to the Lord, okay, Lord, help us! Now you've said the most strongest thing that you could possibly say. Now you're speaking with authority. Now you're speaking with some mighty power when you say those words, Lord, help us! Whoa. To the world, that's weak. To the world, it's like, yeah, you can't do nothing. You got to call on people. So they call out to the Lord. And the angel of the Lord says that the angel of the Lord comes up to Gideon. And Gideon is threshing wheat in a wine press. I don't know if anybody knows what a wine press is, but it's like this, contraption that like crushes the grapes, I guess. Crushes them and it creates wine. But Gideon is there threshing wheat in the wine press because he's worried that the Midianites are going to see the wheat that they have. So he's there hiding it just in the wine, just threshing the wheat, trying to see that the Midianites are around. They're going to take his food. Chicken. And the angel of the Lord comes up to Gideon and says, greetings, mighty warrior. And Gideon's like, whoa, wait a minute. Out of the 12 tribes of Israel, I'm in the tribe of Manasseh, if I said that right, which is one of the weakest tribes. My clan is the weakest clan in Manasseh, and I am the weakest member of that clan, but I'm a mighty warrior. I think you missed someone. Angel of the Lord, there's probably someone over there that you were trying to go talk to. No, you, Gideon,
You're the mighty warrior. Because God didn't look at Gideon just on his own. God looked at Gideon of what God could do through Gideon. But Gideon said, no, you don't understand. This is all that I am, and I will never be able to do that. But God looks at each and every single one of us of what the capabilities he has to do through us. And that's why he looked at Gideon and said, greetings, mighty warrior. Because he knew if he said, Lord, help me, that's exactly what he would be, a mighty warrior. So Gideon decides, okay, Lord, you're calling me. Calling me to help. You're going to do something through me. But Gideon was a chicken. And he's like, give me a sign. Show me that it's really you, God. Show me that it's really you. And a few things happen with the fleece. Gideon just like, if the fleece is wet tomorrow morning and the ground is dry, I don't know it's you, God. And it happens. And then the next day he goes, okay, Lord, this time, if the ground is wet and the fleece is dry, then I'll know it's you. And it happens. Gideon is really trying everything he possibly can to confirm that he's not supposed to go do this. Because he's scared. Don't want to do this, God. Are you sure? Yes, mighty warrior. Yes, mighty warrior. So Gideon decides that he's going to go. And he's preparing all the men, and they're getting ready to go to battle against the Midianites. We could do this. Gideon looks around. He says, I got 32,000 men here with me on my side. The Midianites had 135,000 of them. It's okay, though. We can still do this, guys. God is with us. The Lord is with us. The Lord will give us victory on this day. We have 32,000 of us here. Ten a person, we can come. And they're pumped up, and they're ready to go. And they're like, we're going to take these enemies out because they have no authority to even be here. These are strongholds in our life that aren't supposed to be here right now. Brother Fowl talked about strongholds are right up in here, the mind, all in the mind. So if you're walking around saying, I got no peace, I'm troubled, I'm afraid. When we can acknowledge that, when we can acknowledge that that's not what God says. Wait a minute. I'm troubled and I'm afraid and I have no peace, but that's not what Scripture says. In John 14, 27, it says, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Let not those be troubled nor afraid. So whatever things that are coming through here, whatever thoughts are coming into our head that we're weak, or we don't have any peace, or we're troubled, we need to take Scripture, and we need to stand on it and say, no, because Scripture says this. This cannot affect me because Scripture says this. God says that He gives me peace. God says that I'll never be troubled, and I'll never be afraid. So whatever this thought is going through my head that says I have no peace, or my life is messed up, or my life is afraid, God says something different. And if we can consistently, on a daily basis, speak that word to those thoughts that come into our heads. Speak the word to the issues that are among us. Oh, we'll start to walk in the power of the Lord. But here's the thing. The bully that comes up to the little kid, give me your lunch money. And the bell rings and some commotion happens, so the bully actually has to leave. And the little kid's just like, yes. My stronghold that's walking away from me. Great, I'm good right now for a moment. And the next bell comes around and the bully comes back looking for him saying, hey, give me your money. And all of a sudden something else happens and there's confusion and the bully leaves again. And the guy's just like, yes, okay, I'm good again. I'm good. There's no stronghold here. But then the bully comes back again, and he comes back even more vicious, even more meaner than he's ever been, because he wants this lunch money, and he's got to get it. And that's what happens in our walk. We're walking out, and some troubling thing happens, and we're like, you know what? That's cool. The Lord is my strength. I'm going past this. something else happens, a little bit worse, and we say, you know what, that's cool. The Lord is my strength. I'm good with this. And then all of a sudden, really, really bad happens. Or something just happens. And we're just like, oh my God, I can't do it. I just need to fix this problem. If I can just put all this back together and put all these things right in the right place, and then I can get back to just serving God. And God's just like, no, I want to work through you in this mess, this pile of mess that you got right here. I want to work through you. I don't want you to clean it up for yourself and then say, all right, God, I'm ready to go. I want to do it. And when I do it, that thing's never coming back. When you do it, it's coming back. I can promise you that. Strongholds will continue to come back because strongholds come right from Satan, and Satan's been defeated, not by us, but by Christ Jesus our Lord. He's been defeated. So if we stand on that word, if we acknowledge how powerful our God is, then no matter what stronghold comes against us, it is defeated. And it's only a matter of time before we really start believing it and understanding it and taking authority over it. So here Gideon is with these 32,000 men, ready to go. And the Lord comes and says, wait, you got too many men. There's 135,000 Midianites over there, God. We only have 32,000. Remember, I'm the weakest of Manasseh. Remember, my clan is the weakest. Remember, I'm like the low of the low of the low of the low. What are you talking about, Lord? This already took me enough to acknowledge that you're really going to do something with 32,000, but now you want to take more men away? Yeah. Because if you do it with the men that you have, then the people will boast against me. They'll think that they did it on their own. He's like, I don't want that to happen. I really want you to get it this time, that the Lord is doing this, and you're not doing nothing. So 22,000 men left. And Gideon's here now with just 10,000 of them against 135,000. And you got to think, Gideon's probably maybe shuffling a little bit further back through those rows. Yeah, you guys are the frontliners. Go ahead. You got this. Go ahead. Go back. You got 10,000.